Good morning and welcome to our service of Eucharist this morning as we keep the Feast of Palm Sunday, as we begin our journey towards the cross on Good Friday and the resurrection next Sunday on Easter Day. A very warm welcome to anyone who's here for the first time or who is joining us through our YouTube channel. We hope that you find something of use to you in this service. So now let us pray for a closer union with Christ in his suffering and in his glory. True and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us the faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross, which is the path of glory. Amen. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, and I did not turn backwards. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? All of them will wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them up. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We remain seated now as we listen to the words of the servant king. As this is a very long passion reading, I suggest that we remain seated for the reading of it. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
"Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people."
While he was at Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly, I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him, one after another,
"Surely not I."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
Even though all become deserters, I will not.
Jesus said to him,
Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But Peter said vehemently,
Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them,
I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake.
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want.
He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray, that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
"Prophesy."
The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
And he broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some crowns into some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him.
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he is calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James the Younger and of Joseph, and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, so saw where the body was laid. This is the Passion of the Lord.
Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I can hardly believe that it's a whole year since we entered lockdown and the regular rhythm of the church was disrupted along with much else in life. I remember sending out palm crosses to everyone in preparation for last year's Palm Sunday, in the knowledge that Holy Week would be very different, and it was. The Jews of Jesus' time had their religious rhythms too. Weekly visits to the local synagogue, and an annual trip to the temple in Jerusalem for the time of the Passover, We only have sketchy evidence for Jesus' visits to the temple, one as an eight-day-old baby for his presentation, a reference to his family's annual trips in the story of him being left behind in the temple at Jerusalem as a 12-year-old boy. He's turning over the tables in the temple, either at the beginning or at the end of his ministry, depending on which gospel you read. But this visit to Jerusalem is different from all others, however many there were. In Luke's gospel, we hear that Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem. This is no ordinary visit. This is to be his final visit to the Jerusalem temple. But how does Jesus know this? Is it fate? Is it his intention to die? Is he going to Jerusalem seeking death? Anyone who has been involved in palliative care will have heard of the principle of double effect. For some patients, the morphine required to free them from pain is enough to kill them. When considering the ethics of administering what is known to be a lethal dose, the clinician is protected by this principle of double effect. Their primary reason for administering it is to alleviate their pain. But it has the double effect of ending the person's life. If the clinician's primary reason was to end their life, that would be unethical. But what on earth has this got to do with Jesus' trip to Jerusalem? Well, one quick question which is problematic for me about the cross is whether Jesus' death is somehow required or planned, either by himself or by the Father. Could a loving heavenly Father, or even an earthly one for that matter, knowingly send his son to his death in order to fulfill some vast eternal plan, a la Fiddler on the Roof? Is that the God we worship? Is that a God worthy of worship? This is where the double effect, I think, becomes important. If it is the Father's will that Jesus should die, then that must be ethically questionable. But it's all too easy to forget, as some do, about the life, the teaching, the example of Jesus, glossing over it, as in the Apostles' Creed, with little more than a comma. Born of the Virgin Mary, comma, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. But Jesus was not sent to die. Jesus was sent to live. He set his face towards Jerusalem, not to die, but to live out his own teaching, the teaching he had learned from the Father, and accepting the consequences, whatever they may be. As we heard in last week's gospel, very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. I don't believe Jesus wanted to die, but he knew the double effect of standing up to the rulers of this world, the Romans and the religious establishment, might end up with that. No wonder he is troubled at the thought. Jesus was savvy enough to know that those who advocated the law, both Roman and Mosaic, and perhaps even in our own time, are capable of bending the law or even of ignoring it when their own purposes are threatened. But God? At morning prayer during Passiontide, we are invited to say these words from Lamentations. For the Lord will not reject forever. Though he causes grief, he will have compassion. According to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. As we enter this Holy Week, I would ask you to ponder this question for yourself. If the Father intended Jesus to die, can I worship him? Amen. So now let us pray for the church and for the world. Let us thank God for his loving kindness to us all. Let us pray.
In our prayers today, your response to the words, "Let us pray to the Lord," is, "Lord, have mercy." Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord have mercy.
Loving God, as Christ entered Jerusalem, so let him enter our lives and rule in our hearts. Help us to welcome him as the crowds did, but to stay faithful, even when life gets tough or public opinion mocks faith. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord have mercy.
We pray for our parish and we give thanks for this chance to gather again together to worship. Unite us with those worshipping at home via the internet. Together may we proclaim your love and welcome those around us to join our church community. Strengthen all who serve you here at St. George's and contribute in any way to our life together. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We ask your blessing on the worldwide church in all its variety and traditions as we prepare to again celebrate the resurrection this coming Easter. In our own denomination, we pray for Archbishop Justin, Bishops Christopher and Jonathan, Archdeacon Rosemary, Area Dean Debbie, and for Barry, our vicar. And we pray for our sister churches here in Shirley, especially this week, for the Church of God Apostolic, St. John the Evangelist, and Shirley Methodist Church. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Loving God, we pray for all who are at the mercy of fickle popularity. Give to governments the strength to hold to what is true and right and serves the common good, rather than to seek crowd-pleasing solutions. Bless all who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and for peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We bring before you all who live in fear of violence, natural disaster, climate change, or political oppression, and those suffering from famine or disease. We pray especially today for the peoples of the Yemen, of South Sudan, of Myanmar, of Hong Kong, of Tigray, Ethiopia and Eritrea, of Zimbabwe, and for all refugees. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Creator God, as we give thanks for the growing signs of spring, we ask you that we may learn to live more lightly on this planet, that we may be good stewards of your abundant creation. May its blessings be shared by all your children, both today and in the years ahead. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Loving God, we thank you for those we live alongside in our homes and families and neighborhoods. Give us the courage to reach out with a smile to strangers, willing ears to listen to friends and family, patience with those we find annoying. We pray for the homes and families of this parish. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
have mercy. Lord Jesus Christ, in your passion we see our human frailty. Be with all whose endurance is strained, whose spirit is weakened by illness, stress, disability, or anxiety. Be with those who care for them and watch with them. May they all find support and encouragement through your healing presence.
Especially we pray for Elsie Lennell, Elaine Cook, Sonia, Jean, Gunnar Pereira, Dave Ashdown, Hazel Stiles, Marjorie Griffiths, David Lorne, Doreen Janssen, Sue Moore, Margaret Easton, Mark Hare, Chris Chestnut, Bill Gibson, Garth Smith, Angela Perry, Sheila Dennis, Lindsay Morgan, Julie, Anne Bloss, Clive and Norma Pearson, Sue Hengist, Frank Garrett, Claire Piner, Hugh Aylward, Elizabeth Lovell, Valerie Duncan, Martin Pitt, Brian, Catriona, Brian Jacobs, Hal Bittner, Christine Evans, Eric Webb, Doris Hazelwood, Doreen Wash, Barbara Ramsashit, Ron Parsons, and Jean Wells. And we remember those known only to us, and those who have no one to pray for them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord
have mercy. Loving God, give us the courage to give up our fear of death. Trusting in your mercy and forgiveness, we remember before you those who have died recently, Don Brown and Jim Forbes. And we remember those whose anniversaries of death occur about this time. Raymond Michael Fenner, Percy Brownsmith, Ada Emily Hawkins, Frances Helen Hickmott, Frieda Doris Haysham, Leonard Eric Pearson, Jean Clark, and Nicola Jane Martin. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please would you stand for the peace. Observing social distancing, of course, we have this opportunity to greet each other with a sign of peace. And those who are at home, if you too are sharing worship with other people, then this is your opportunity to offer that sign of peace. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you, Ray. Peace be with you, Owen. Peace be with you. We listen now to our offertory hymn, King of Kings, Majesty. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For as the time of his passion and resurrection draws near, the whole world is called to acknowledge his hidden majesty. The power of the life-giving cross reveals the judgment that has come upon the world, and the triumph of Christ crucified. He is the victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain who lives forever, our advocate in heaven to plead our cause, exalting us there to join with angels and archangels, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory.
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with Our Lady, the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. George, and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Standing at the foot of the cross, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Every time this bread is eaten, every time this cup is sipped, from the chains of death forever, we proclaim our Lord has slipped. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. At the time of communion, please do follow the instructions from our church warden, Jan, and come up to the altar. We will receive standing, and I would ask you to please keep your masks on until you return to your seat, at which time I will then ask us all to take our masks off to receive together. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. Christ. Please would you stand to remove your masks as we receive our Lord together. The body of Christ. Amen. Amen. The blood of Christ. Amen. Please be seated. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. Give us the will to be servants of others, as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, but are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Strengthen us in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And now a prayer for our children and young people. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the children and young people of this parish family. Bless and guide all those who encourage them on their journey of faith, today and always. Amen. And we remember our young people today being led by Sheila and Susan, on the Zoom that we have established during lockdown, and which seems to be carrying on now into the future, and very successful it seems to be. So thank Thank you to Susan and to Sheila for leading them this morning, and for our young people for being so faithful in their attendance. As far as notices go, please make sure you take or print off your pew sheet. It has all the details there for this Holy Week coming up. We have something on every evening, Monday to Wednesday, 7:30 here in church, so a devotion of some sort or another. There'll be Stations of the Cross and various other devotions. Thursday is the Zoom Agape, which Reverend Hilary Fife is leading us in. So please have a look at the newsletter about how to join that. Good Friday, the Hour by the Cross, starting at 2 o'clock. Please, if you are intending to come, can you let Jan know in good time that you're intending to come so that she can make sure you've got a place allocated? And the same goes for Easter Day. Please make sure you let Jan know if you are intending to come, and let's hope we can get this place as full as we safely can to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord next Sunday. There will be coffee after the church online, not this morning, I'm afraid, not here in reality. So when that is allowed by the government, then obviously we will implement that as quickly as possible. I'm sure you're all dying to have a chat with one another. Could I ask you, please, as we leave today, if you could, rather than hanging around in the church, if you could go outside for a quick chat if you want, but make sure it's still socially distanced. We don't want the COVID police coming around knocking on our doors. So, as we prepare to go back into the world, let's stand and ask for God's blessing. God, who from the death of sin raised you to new life in Christ, keep you from falling and set you in the presence of his glory. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.